Simon & Schuster Audio presents Star Trek, the original series, Living Memory, by Christopher L. Bennett. Based on Star Trek, created by Gene Roddenberry. Read by Robert Petkoff. For Nichelle Nichols. Remember thee? Aye, thou poor ghost, while memory holds a seat in this distracted globe, remember thee? Yea, from the table of my memory I'll wipe away all trivial fond records, all saws of books, all forms, all pressures past, that youth and observation copied there. And thy commandment all alone shall live within the book and volume of my brain, unmixed with baser matter. William Shakespeare, Hamlet. Historian's note. The events of this story take place in the summer and autumn of 2279, approximately 6 years after the reunited crew of the USS Enterprise saves Earth from a powerful machine life form called V'ger, Star Trek The Motion Picture, and 6 years prior to Khan Noonien Singh's escape from exile on SETI Alpha 5, Star Trek II: The Wrath of Khan. Prologue. Passenger Transport Baloo, Iota Leonis System. Michael Ashrafi leaned against the forward viewport, straining his eyes as if it would somehow bring Argelius II into view sooner.
Argelius, here we come!
The call suppressed a twinge of annoyance. As I have stated 5 previous times, Michael, the Vulcan youth said, it is Argelius. A voiced velar plosive, as opposed to a voiced palato-alveolar affricate. How illogical that your alphabet employs the same symbol for both.
It's perfectly logical, countered Zirani Kairos with an impish tilt to her hairless head. Alphabets evolve over time and must adapt their existing symbols to new or foreign sounds. The Tiburonian tapped one of her broad, elaborately contoured ears. Sometimes they lack enough symbols to cover them all.
Then they could simply add diacritical marks to clarify the distinction. Michael scoffed, crossing his arms over his bright red shirt.
You're one to talk about logic, Vikal. How logical is it for a Vulcan to sneak off on a pleasure trip to sample the hedonistic wonders of Argelius?
Vikal fidgeted in his seat. Respect for infinite diversity requires study and understanding. I am simply here to observe how Argelian civilization has managed to achieve 2 centuries of peace while freely indulging emotional desire as opposed to restraining it. If I am to work with emotional beings once we begin our term at Starfleet Academy, Kairos chuckled.
So, you thought you'd sample a few of those indulgences for yourself, right? Strictly in the name of immersion anthropology.
She leaned closer, affecting a pretense of seductive behavior.
Admit it, Vikal. Vulcan teenagers are as curious about sex as the rest of us, aren't you?
Vikal had never expected to be so relieved by the sound of a navigational hazard alert. Reflexively, he turned to look out the forward port, where brilliant pinpoints of light were flashing briefly into existence, almost blinding him before the port's filters engaged to dim the view. As the Baloo began to decelerate and turn, the pilot's voice emanated from the intercom.
Passengers, please return to your seats. We're encountering some kind of gravimetric and EM turbulence. I'm bringing us briefly to a relative halt while I assess. Ah! Suddenly, the blinding lights were inside the ship, just for a moment or two as it passed through the edge of the effect, despite the pilot's efforts to avoid it. The result was akin to a lightning strike inside the compartment,
the heat searing Vikal's skin and the shockwaves in the air deafening him. When he gathered himself afterward, he noted that the engines had shut down and the display screens were dark. The overhead lights flickered, and the air carried the scent of burned circuits and vaporized metals. Glancing at the viewport, Vikal saw that the Baloo was in a slow rotation. He looked toward the cockpit, but Kairos had already recovered and was climbing the gangway leading up to it. Sliding the door open, she looked inside and gasped. Vikal strove to make out her words over the ringing in his ears.
"Get the medkit! I think he's been shot!"
It was an illogical assumption. More likely, one of the pinpoint energy anomalies had passed through the Argelian pilot's body, as they presumably had with the engines.
"Send a distress call," he said loudly as Michael went for the medical kit.
Kairos checked the console and shook her head.
"The power's down!"
It was reasonable to surmise that the craft had an automatic distress beacon with independent power, but there was no way to be certain. Vikal put that matter aside for now. The pilot was the first priority. Michael gave him a wry look as he handed over the medkit.
"See, this is what you get when a Vulcan tries to have a good time."
USS Reliant, NCC 1864, approaching Iota Leonis system.
"Any luck yet, Mr. Chekov?"
Commander Pavel Chekov frowned at the radiometrics display on his science console, making one more attempt to refine its scan settings.
"Negative, Captain," he told Clark Terrell, who hovered over his left shoulder.
In his months aboard Reliant, Chekov had learned that the burly, bearded captain was the populist type, often found pacing the outer ring of bridge stations to get his crew's reports at close range rather than holding court from the captain's chair in the center. Chekov appreciated Terrell's personal touch most of the time, but having his commanding officer looming over him when answers were slow in coming was not his favorite sensation.
"We are not quite close enough to separate out the source of the sensor interference," Chekov went on, looking up into Terrell's broad brown face. "Radiometric readings are still blended in with the flux from Argelius' sun, while gravimetric and subspace readings are intermingled with the heavy warp traffic around the planet. It is a popular tourist destination, of course."
"Which is exactly what worries me."
Terrell strode forward two stations, allowing the tension in Chekov's shoulders to ease slightly.
"Any luck cleaning up that distress signal, Lieutenant Kyle?"
The fair, goateed Englishman looked up from the communication station.
"Nearly there, sir. The interference is rising and falling in surges, but it seems to be diminishing overall, and of course the gain increases as we get closer. I'm getting fragments now. I estimate another minute or two."
Terrell nodded.
"Do your best, John."
He turned to the helm.
"Stoney, any chance of gaining a bit more speed?"
"We're maxed out already, sir,"
Lieutenant Commander Ralston Beach replied in his pronounced New York accent.
"In fact, I don't like going this fast into a high-traffic area with low sensor visibility."
"Needs must as the devil drives, Stoney."
"Even the devil would slow down if he were driving into that mess, Captain."
Terrell chuckled.
"Touché."
The talk of the devil brought Chekov no reassurance. His first visit to Argelius II had been a dozen years earlier on shore leave from the Enterprise after a series of stressful missions. The visit had been very, well, relaxing was hardly the word, but quite pleasant and fulfilling for a 22-year-old ensign on his first visit to a hedonistic society. He had gone down to the surface in a shore party, including Lieutenant Uhura, who had promptly lit out on her own pursuits, as they had not yet become more than casual friends. It had been a rewarding but blurry few days, at least for Chekov. Uhura had also seemed highly satisfied when he had seen her again at the transporter station, but he had respected her privacy. However, once they returned to the Enterprise, they had been shocked to discover that the vessel had been invaded in their absence by a murderous incorporeal entity calling itself Redjack. which claimed to have been Jack the Ripper and other infamous serial killers from history, or rather, to have possessed and controlled their bodies, as it had possessed a local administrator who had killed several Argelian women, as well as Karen Tracy, a medical technician Chekov had been rather fond of. Naturally, Captain Kirk and Mr. Spock had managed to save the day, beaming the entity's deceased host body into open space on wide dispersal. Chekov hadn't been sure if he was glad or sorry to have missed it, given that most of his crewmates were still coming down from the tranquilizer high Dr. McCoy had put them on to starve the entity of the fear that sustained it. Lieutenant Sulu seemed to have had nearly as good a time at the helm station as Chekov had on the planet. But who could really say what it would take to kill an incorporeal entity that had survived for centuries? Chekov knew from his recent experience with the Spectres that it was possible to kill such an entity while it was joined to a humanoid host, but Red Jack had evidently been able to jump between hosts far more readily, even possessing the Enterprise computer for a time. What if dispersing its transporter beam had only weakened it temporarily? Could these disruptions affecting multiple ships near Argelius be a sign of its restoration? Chekov reined in his imagination. He was Reliant's chief science officer. His job was to formulate hypotheses based on evidence, not speculation and old fears. Soon they would have more information about the nature of the disruptions, and Chekov could practically hear Spock's voice in his head reminding him to take the time to fill the gaps in his knowledge with data rather than hastening to fill them with conjecture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.